Welcome at kNews.space. I'm Lucas from Germany, and today I want to invite you on a little journey through near-Earth space. We'll have a brief look at Starlink, the non-geosynchronous communication system by SpaceX. I'll try to illustrate how it will change the future and show that it's not as ludicrous as it seems. Let's dive into it. The dotted outer rim to the sides shows regular communication satellites in a geosynchronous orbit. There are roughly 500 of these currently in orbit, and most of you will know them from satellite television. Yep, that's where you point your dishes at. The ISS orbits much more closely at 400 kilometers. In fact, it's so close you wouldn't even notice it's in space at all from up here. The red dot zips across the sky at 8 kilometers a second in order to not fall back to ground. It counters gravity with its own inertia like a giant centrifuge. The Starlink constellation will have a very similar orbit, but there will be many, many more. This is no coincidence because SpaceX will launch from the same launch site in Florida, and that's the highest inclination they can still reach somewhat efficiently. The first batch you can see here consists of almost 1600 satellites distributed over 24 orbital planes, with 66 each, not counting on-orbit spares. These spare satellites are basically a buffer to make sure a failing satellite can be replaced quickly. The first constellation will operate from an altitude of 550 kilometers and will be able to communicate with itself and the ground using microwaves, similar to your smartphones. But don't get too excited about that. 550 kilometers is not in reach for any regular smartphone, so you will not be able to browse the web like that. At least not in regular fashion, but we'll discuss that later. The plan is to use dishes on terminals which can track the satellites by simply following them. This will change and modernize over time as SpaceX usually does. They will iterate on the design of the satellites and terminals, starting with the most basic of hardware, evolving them into whatever proves the best over time. They have actually launched two test articles to space already as a secondary payload, Tintin A and B, named after the Belgian comics character Tintin or Tintin. They work for in the order of 15 minutes a day as they fly by the US with high bandwidth and 25 milliseconds of latency. Speaking of latency, this used to be the issue with satellite communication, as it was for the most part using those geosynchronous orbits far out. The speed of light is 300,000 kilometers a second, so in order for a signal to bounce back and forth twice for a ping pong or ping test, it would travel at least 140,000 kilometers or roughly half a second. That's a big delay, which is fine for one-directional streaming, but incredibly painful for anything else, especially online gaming. But wait a second, one-directional streaming? Yep. I would argue what many don't count with when it comes to Starlink is streaming. You could in theory use regular cellular internet to ask for data and then use StarNet to provide it in even the most remote of areas directly onto a mobile device. However, that's just my speculation, and it really depends on whether the signal strength is strong enough to be picked up with an antenna that fits inside a smartphone. But I can imagine companies could sell pocket dishes with receivers only, which don't require special radio licenses. Anyhow, important to note is SpaceX could bring satellite television to smartphones no matter where you are. I used to think Starlink was completely supplementary to the existing market, as ground-based 5G systems will offer higher speeds and quicker latency, but as it turns out, they could really threaten those valuable satellite television companies that ironically fund SpaceX today by launching satellites with them. But that of course depends on whether SpaceX will make use of it or not. In the end, there is enough streaming you can do online, which will probably exploit most of the bandwidth already. What SpaceX could also do is to mount GPS transmitters to offer positioning services. Thinking about it again, that could turn into a problem though, since no government had direct control over it, so bad actors could abuse it to guide missiles. Regular GPS can be turned on and off and even manipulated to send missiles back to where they were coming from. The whole globe is tracked via infrared sensors from space, so any device that exhausts a lot of heat is immediately picked up by the military, which is vital not only to defend attacks but also to prevent people from even attempting it. I guess SpaceX won't offer positioning services, at least without governmental control over it, or only with a very low precision to tell which country you are in and not on which grass holm you're sitting. So what remains is the internet, which is of course the most important communication infrastructure nowadays. It will, as mentioned, offer high bandwidth in the gigabit range per user, but with a comparatively okay latency of round about 10 milliseconds to local servers, or, and this is the main advantage, 30 to 60 milliseconds all across the globe. Yep, it will even beat a direct optical fiber connection, because signals in these fibers travel at only 60 to 70% of the speed of light. The longer the distance, the higher the advantage of such a space-based system. 30 to 60 milliseconds is not great for online shooters, but totally fine for most other games and, of course, calls. But I didn't came up with that one by myself. There is a great video by I think a professor called Mark Handley. He wrote a software to simulate the Constellation's length and latency of the system, pretty much proving the point. I highly recommend to watch it. I have never really thought about satellites being faster than a direct optical fiber link across the ocean. And this initial constellation will, as mentioned, only be the first, and there are many more to come. The final low Earth constellation will consist of almost 5,000 satellites on different orbits, and this is still not all. This will more than double in the long run, as SpaceX will try to utilize very low Earth orbits below 350 kilometers and therefore below the ISS. This one is further out and will probably not fund BFR like the rest. Yep, this whole constellation is supposed to fund SpaceX next-gen rocket, so it is not a 20-year plan, but supposed to be finished in just a few years from now. How can they do it, you may ask? This more than doubles all satellites that are in space today. And won't it cause crashes and debris? Yes, it is not an easy task, but each teal sphere you can see here has actually a purpose. It is 60 kilometers wide, and that is exactly the safe zone around a satellite SpaceX will keep free. Given a perfectly optimized constellation, which mine isn't, none of these spheres should ever intersect with another. That is a lot of safe zone, even if one satellite should fail. It would take many months to drift 60 kilometers of course, in which SpaceX could in theory rendezvous with some kind of orbit garbage collector that could deorbit uncontrolled satellites. What sets SpaceX apart from the others is they are at the source, or they are the source for that matter. Unlike companies that try to do the same, they can use free rockets. Yes, their used boosters are already paid for, so they can start out by simply using and reusing those without having to buy new ones. This is an incredible advantage over any competitor, which won't be able to operate a similar fleet at a competitive price point. Maybe Amazon with their new Glenn rocket, but that's another video. Now of course, satellite won't only fail by accident. If you do the math, 5,000 satellites with a lifespan of 5 years each means 20 satellites failing per week on average. They will not only have to deorbit them on their own, but will also need an insane launch rate to maintain the whole fleet, and they can't yet reuse their upper stage. Building so many new upper stages and satellites will make funding BFR a real challenge. So, and this is just my conclusion, they have to reduce the upper stage for Skynet, Starlink. They can't wait for BFR because it is meant to fund it, and they can hardly fund it by building so many satellites and upper stages. Of course, Elon Musk himself tweeted it out recently. They will indeed try to turn the upper stage in some sort of mini BFR, as I have already talked about in a previous video. Feel free to check that one out if you haven't or want to refresh your memory. Now, let's assume they really do it and manage to reuse it. What's with all the debris falling to ground? 20 satellites burning up a week or 1,000 per year is insane. According to SpaceX simulations, there is also a high chance of a couple kilograms of metal surviving re-entry, and these pieces will re-enter and crash into the ground somewhere. Of course, most will do so into the ocean, but some will inevitably crash into the ground. They could harm people and even cause wildfires. That's quite the long-term risk to take, so I personally believe SpaceX will, at least in the long run, as their satellites mature, have to come up with something new again. Reusable satellites. Yep, mounting a small heat shield, maybe protective housing and parachute is all it takes. A mini dragon, so to speak. Refueling satellites on orbit would be probably too complex, as there are so many in different planes and they also can't really upgrade them like that. If they decide to go for reusable satellites, the next problem will be catching them. That's 1,000 satellites a year. How could they possibly prevent them from falling into the water? First of all, SpaceX is incredibly good at aiming, as they do it on the Dragon all the time. so I'm sure they could re-enter and aim for somewhere near the west coast. Second, they could not use drone ships but regular flying drones. There is an older video linked below where you can see how students or graduates, I'm not sure, build software that can control a team of drones catching a ball using a net in flight. That's crazy, but I think just the right way to do it. Mr. Steven, who usually catches fairings, could harbor some car-sized drones that would do exactly that, catch satellites. This could even turn into a fully autonomous launch and catch cycle. Drones catch the satellites, bring them to the rocket where they get refueled and relaunched. Isn't it a good idea to build a self-maintaining satellite fleet that offers communication, possibly positioning, to autonomous vehicles all around the globe? Wait a second, that reminds me of the documentary. What was its name again? The Terminator. But jokes aside, what do you think, guys? The Skynet comparison is surely a little exaggerated, but do you believe they could disrupt yet another industry with reusable satellites? Or am I nuts? Do you have some cool ideas what Starlink could else be used for? Let me know, and also don't forget to watch the videos I mentioned, especially the ones with drones and the one with a simulation. Okay, that shall conclude this video, and I hope to see you next one if you like. In the end, I want to also give a big shout out to my kNews boosters on Patreon. These people put the K before the news. Thanks for your trust. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.